Hi, I'm Dr. Allen, here with Focus on Your Pet. Today I'm going to talk to you about a day in the life of a veterinarian. Every day I talk to people who tell me, Dr. Allen, I didn't know y'all could do that. And I think, you know, there's a whole lot of things that I do on a very regular basis that a lot of people, if they haven't had that specific problem with their pet and needed that service, they have no idea of what we can do. So I thought I'd take this opportunity to talk about some of the things I do during the course of my normal working day that you may have never encountered. And hopefully, if you know it exists, if you see a need, you'll know where to go to get that problem addressed. First and foremost, your veterinarian is an advocate for the pet. You know, the pet can't talk. You know, the pet can't tell you what they need. The pet doesn't know, in a lot of cases, what's the best thing for it. So our job as veterinarians is to be an advocate for the pet, for its nutrition, for its health maintenance, for its care if it's hurt or injured, for its management when it has diseases and problems that need managing, and ultimately, at the end of things, you know, helping the clients and the pet with end-of-life decisions. So we're first and foremost advocates for the pet. The biggest part of my job is education, educating the clients, the pet owners, about their pet, about what their pet needs and why they need it, and ways they can go about getting things taken care of. Veterinarians are often detectives. You know, our pets can't talk to us. So we spend a lot of our time, you know, observing, you know, watching their body language, watching how they hold themselves, watching their expressions, you know, looking at the pet, talking to the owner, you know, taking a history to try and figure out what's going on, what's wrong with this particular patient, and what do I need to do to get to the bottom of whatever the problem is, and then what do I need to do to formulate a plan to hopefully bring this pet back to the best that it can be, to have the best quality of life, and to have the most potential to be a good companion and part of this family. First place we always start is with a history. You know, what's going on? I often walk in the room and say, hi, I'm Dr. Allen. Tell me what's going on. And the clients will talk. They'll say, you know, it's been losing weight, it's not eating well, it's having some loose stools, it's been vomiting, it's been coughing, it's been scratching, you know, any number of things. And just getting the idea of what their ideas are for what they're seeing. And very often I'll interject some things. I'll say, you know, is the weight up or down? You know, is the appetite up or down? How about urinary habits? You know, is it getting around? Is it just as playful as usual or not? And taking a very complete history often will help me to focus in on what systems are involved and figure out, you know, what needs to happen. Very often as I'm talking and taking that history, I'm doing a physical exam. Now, very often the clients don't realize that I'm doing a complete physical while I'm sitting there chatting. They think I'm petting the dog. But what I'm doing is I'm sitting here, I'm looking at them, I'm checking their eyes, I'm seeing if they're red or inflamed, I'm seeing if their pupils are equal and responding to light, I'm seeing if there's any tumors or masses around there, I'm seeing how they respond, looking for any discharge, I'll lift their lip, I'll check their teeth, I'll check their gums, I'll look back through here, I'll assess their nostrils, see if there's any discharge or drainage. I'll look at the teeth back in here. I'll sometimes open their mouth. I'll look at their tonsils and their palate. Look at the teeth back in the back. I'll do all these things. I'm just standing here petting the dog. I'll look at their ears. I'll check for drainage and discharge. I'll look for ear mites and signs of infection. I'll look for masses, those sorts of things. I'll check both ears. Not good to check one ear. You may have a problem just in the other ear. I'll feel down through here. I'll check their lymph nodes. You know, dogs have lymph nodes just like people do. Enlarged lymph nodes can be signs of infection. They can also be early signs of a type of cancer called lymphoma. I'll move their legs. You know, I'll check their nails. I'll flex and extend their joints, looking for joint pain. And even if they've not come in for anything related to any of these things, I try to do a very complete physical exam every time I examine the patient. I'll work down through here. I'll palpate their abdomen. I'm feeling for tenseness. Are they tense and painful in their abdomen? Are they relaxed? Do I feel masses? Is their abdomen distended? I'll feel on their ribs. Do they have the right amount of body weight? Are they overweight or are they underweight? I'm feeling down through here. I'll reach inside their thigh right here and I'll check the pulse. You check a dog's pulse on the inside of their thigh. I'll feel their pulse to see if their pulse is good and strong and steady. I'll often check back through. They have lymph nodes back here. I'll check their joints back in this area. I'll check their hips, right in here is where the dog's hip is. I'll check their knees. We'll sometimes see torn cruciate ligaments. We'll see kneecap problems, any number of things we can see in dogs. I'll take my stethoscope and listen to their chest. I'm listening for heart murmurs, listening for irregular arrhythmias, listening to the lungs, see if they have any sign of congestion or fluid in their lungs or around their heart. I'm doing all of these things while I'm talking to the client, getting a history. The majority of the time, by the time I'm finished taking a history and doing my physical exam, I have a pretty good idea about what's going on. But many times too, I'll need to do additional testing. And we have a whole bunch of things available. There's a lot available in a private practice. I can take x-rays if I'm worried about, you know, the heart being enlarged or a mass or a broken bone. X-rays can tell us a lot of things. We have an ultrasound. If some things are imaged better with an ultrasound than with x-rays. I have the equipment to take blood and do lab work, check blood chemistries, look at the liver, the kidneys, the blood sugar, look at a blood count. Doing those things I can do right there in my hospital and often have the answers, the results back the same day, and therefore can use that to make a plan. At that point, I may know what's wrong. Then I can go ahead and make the plan and we'll get the animal hopefully on the road to recovery. Sometimes that's not enough. You know, sometimes there'll be a lump or bump. You'd have a biopsy. We can send off biopsy samples. Sometimes I'll find things that I'm not sure about. You know, I've been doing this for almost 30 years, but almost every week I'll encounter something new. Lots of resources available when that happens. The practice I work in has 5 veterinarians, so I'm constantly getting second, third, and fourth opinions. And that's common practice in every multi-vet practice, is you're always getting multiple opinions on hard cases. I can call experts. We use a large commercial lab for our lab work. They keep a whole bunch of board-certified experts in neurology, internal medicine, endocrinology, all sorts of things that I can call them and get advice for them about what we can do. I can pick up the phone and call other labs we use. It's amazing how many resources are available to a veterinarian. Had a client several months ago, had a problem with the dog. They were concerned about distemper. Well, I picked up the phone and called Michigan State University, which is one of the labs we use to send samples to. Talked to the technician there. She put me on the phone with a gentleman who turned out to be the head of the department for virology at Michigan State. He took my questions and we talked for a little bit and he goes, well, I'm not sure, but I have a colleague in Switzerland who's one of the leading people in the world in research on distemper. Let me get in touch with him and I'll call you back. In a few days, I got in touch with him again, and he had talked to his colleague in Switzerland, who's one of the leading people in the world about distemper, to get me information to give to my client. So here I am, you know, a general spinal muscle practitioner in Bristol, Tennessee, and with 2 phone calls, I had access to someone who's one of the leading experts in the world on a disease that my client had a question about. And that sort of thing happens all the time. It's a really neat profession when you can pick up the phone and very often talk to the person who wrote the book or wrote the article in a journal to get further information about a specific problem. So we have lots of things available to us as veterinarians to help us to diagnose, make a treatment plan, and get your pet back to health. Now, sometimes we can't do it. You know, sometimes there's things there we're just not equipped to handle in a general spinal muscle practice. Well, there's lots of referral practices available where we can send things, and we do referrals. The veterinary schools, there's one down at UT at Knoxville, there's one at Blacksburg at Virginia Tech, have very good veterinary schools with specialists on board. They do research, and they are a specialty referral practice for things that can't be done in a local practice. They have board-certified surgeons, internal medicine people, they can do MRIs, radiation therapy for cancer, all sorts of things that we can't do in a small practice. In the last decade, there have been more and more large private specialty practices where board-certified specialists engage in surgery, internal medicine, oncology, which is cancer treatment, things along those lines to help patients that can't be helped on a local level in a small private veterinary hospital. There are a lot of options. And one of the things I do is try to give each client as complete a list as I can of what their options are to take the best care of their pet. I have an obligation to give each client all the options. You know, which option they choose is entirely up to them, and there's no judgment involved on any veterinarian's part about which option a client chooses. You know, some clients, you know, want to go to the platinum, and some, you know, just can't do that, and that's okay. Each client does the best they can with what they have to work with. My job is to give them options and do the best job that I can, and then I will do all I can to work within what that each client can do to take care of their pet and hopefully return them to health and function and let them be, you know, all that they can be within that household. I'm Dr. Allen with Focus on Your Pets. I hope this has been helpful.